Luke 11, that's where we're going to be again today. Am I on? Yeah, all right. Am I on? Is this working? This is a great, always technology, something or other. Yay, all right. So, well, I'm just going to talk very loud. Okay, chapter 11, we're studying this passage this week, or for the next several weeks. We're in a series, Cry Out, which is the beginning of an elongated conversation about worship that will last for this entire semester. We need to begin with prayer because prayer is the foundation for worship. If we want to learn how, if we want to practice worshiping God the way he deserves, the way he desires, then we got to start with the cornerstone of that understanding, and it is found in our understanding of prayer. So we're looking at this passage because it gives us a lot of great insights as to the importance of prayer. And we started last week by seeing that Jesus prayed and he modeled prayer. And we said that your desire to pray reveals the depth of your faith. And as Jesus modeled it for us, that we should model it for others. It shouldn't be something that we do just before meals or transitions in a service or just routine things. It should be something that becomes a large part of our life and how we think and how we do things, how we process things, how we interact with others. And prayer is an important part of that. So today we're going to look at the rest of that verse. We're not going to go very far into the chapter today. We're going to look at the rest of that verse and see that prayer modeled by Jesus is also something that can be learned. Prayer is learned. We're going to see today that learning to pray is learning to worship the way God intended. So let's jump in to chapter 11. Well, before we do that, let me talk about that for just a second, because it reminds me about a problem that I have. And you guys may have the same kind of problem, but for me, I like to learn new things all the time, right? I like to jump into something. We did a series going through the book of Ephesians, and I had never ridden a motorcycle before, and so I was determined to learn how to ride a motorcycle, and it was like it's processed through Ephesians where we talked about restoring a motorcycle, and at the end, it ended on Easter Sunday, and I rode on a motorcycle, and so I was out practicing and learning how to ride a motorcycle, and it was great. And then after that, I was like, man, I'm a motorcycle. I got a license. I'm going to drive, and so I drove for like a month, and then I haven't ridden a motorcycle in forever, right? And it's like I jumped into something. I wanted to learn something new, and it was great until, more practice and costs of gas and just one other thing to take care of. It was just not something I was interested in. I didn't own a motorcycle anyway. I kept borrowing it. So that was a hindrance too. Like guitar. So when I started to learn to play guitar, I didn't want anybody to hear me play when I was just, beating out these chords and I was first starting to learn. But once I had figured out, a couple chords, I wanted everybody, look, I can play the guitar. And that was great until I sat by someone who knew 8 chords, and they're like, oh, well, here, you should try these, or bar chords. And I'm like, what, man, my fingers are bleeding. I can barely do that enough. And I had to make a choice. Am I gonna keep practicing, or am I gonna just gonna be satisfied with where I am? And I did a little bit more, but I finally hit a point where I'm like, I'm good. All right, I've got enough chords. I think I'll just get by with that. So I didn't go any further. So I never learned how to play lead guitar. So I'm always jealous of people over here tapping pedals and playing all kinds of fancy stuff. It's awesome. Tried CrossFit. All right, I will just move on from that. All right, that was good for a short period of time. So I'm always jumping into stuff. I like learning new things, and maybe you're like that. But what's the phrase? Jack of all trades, master of none, right? So I love to jump in, but I'm not proficient in any of these things. I'm not a great guitar player. I definitely am not a great motorcycle rider. And trust me, you don't have to trust me when I say I'm not really good at CrossFit. All right, so I love to jump into these things. I love to learn new things, but it usually comes to a point where I kind of hit a wall. And that's it. That's all I want to put in. That's all the effort and energy I'm going to put into it. And so I never really become proficient. I never really become an expert. I never become really, really good. I learned just enough so that I can be in the conversation with people when I'm around people and they're talking about something. I go, oh, yeah, I know about that, right? And I read a half a book, right? Okay, that's as far as I'm willing to go. But that shouldn't be true for prayer. Prayer should be something that we are we're never satisfied with. We're never okay with just the couple of prayers that we pray or how we pray them. And I imagine there are probably some people in here who don't like to pray. You don't like to pray out loud. You don't want people to hear. You're maybe nervous about it. You probably don't like to talk in front of people, and so prayer just gets lumped into that category. And so maybe you feel like prayer is awkward, and you don't think you have the right words, or you're not sure what to say. And listen to me when I say, like, that's okay, right? That's okay to be wherever you are today, right now, with whatever your prayer life is. Maybe you love to pray, and maybe you love to pray out loud, and maybe you think you have all the great words. And I can say that, like, I love to pray. I love to pray for people. I don't have a problem praying out loud. I got a library of churchy words I can throw out in a prayer, right? I can say all kinds of stuff in prayer. But if we're really honest, whether you pray well or you don't think you pray well, we've all got room to grow. There's so much more to learn. And what we're going to see when we jump into this is that prayer is something that it can be taught. And it should be something that we long to be taught. And in and of itself, when we do pray, it teaches us something. So let's look at it. So let's verse 11, chapter 11, verse 1. Now Jesus was praying in a certain place, and when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray as John taught his disciples." Now we're going to stop right there. That's got a whole bunch in there we need to talk about. That short little bit. So we looked at it last week, and we saw that Jesus prayed. And now we see that a disciple comes to him and asks them to teach him to pray. And we brought it up last week. It's like, it's kind of an odd thing to bring up now. Shouldn't that be kind of an orientation lesson? Why are they just now asking to pray? What's different now? Why was this taught earlier? Why didn't Jesus bring this up earlier? And I think an argument can be made that Jesus doesn't want to force them to pray a certain way or tell them that they have to pray with these specific words or this specific style. He's modeling prayer for them, and they see something different. They're probably used to the kind of prayers they pray in synagogue where someone says something they repeat, or it's just prayer by rote, and they kind of got it memorized. And now here's something done by this guy they're following, and it's very personal. It's very intentional. It has a lot of purpose. And they see it different. They say, "Hey, teach us to pray like this." And so we're going to talk about next week what he says, like how he teaches, what he tells them to pray like this. But it tells us right off the bat that prayer can be taught. Prayer is something that can be learned, and that should get us excited, because it means that if right now you don't think you have the words to pray, that's okay. We can learn. If you don't think you can pray out loud, that's not something that you do. All right. But we shouldn't stay there. We should want to pray better. Maybe you think that you do pray well. Okay, awesome. Can you pray better? Sure. Is there more that you can learn about prayer? Absolutely. In fact, one of the books that I'm reading on prayer, Tim Keller is. I love Tim Keller. I quote him all the time because I love how he thinks and I love the books that he writes. And he talks about when he was diagnosed with cancer, and he was diagnosed. There were several things that were happening all at once, and he thought he knew about prayer, but he didn't. He learned so much more as he began to kind of go back and really study prayer and read the Psalms. He recognized that, man, as much as he taught and thought he knew about prayer, there was so much more for him to learn. Now, when we talk about learning something, I think it's important for us to understand how we learn, right? The disciple says, "Teach us," all right? Well, what is that going to look like to them? Now, they've already seen prayer. Jesus is modeling a different kind of prayer, and so they're going to learn something new. Well, what does that mean, right? Just like anything else that we choose to go after, when I was learning to play guitar, if I set my mind to it, right, I would learn some chords, I'd read something, new information, and I would process it. And if I kept practicing it, then I was learning something. We know that's true, like in math, right? We didn't just start with addition. We started with learning numbers, counting numbers, right? We had to learn what a number was, and then we had to count to 10, and then count to 100, and then we had to add those numbers. And we didn't stop there. We kept learning new things. Well, how did we do that? How did our brain do that? So here's, we're going to get a little science class here. I think this stuff is fascinating. So in our brain, there are special cells called neurons, right? And they're all over the place. And every time we are exposed to new information, these strands, they come out from the neurons, they're called dendrites, right? They just come out, right? And whenever it connects, whenever we see something and like the math problem is done, 2 + 2 = 4, and you're like, two apples, four apples, oh, I get it. It's these dendrites connect. These synapses on the end, the connectors, they connect the dendrites together, and you've learned something, right? But it's fragile. It's fragile. It's why your math teacher gives you so much homework. Oh, my goodness, right? And so you have to keep doing it. You have to keep adding, and you keep connecting the synapses. Eventually, it becomes pretty strong. And as the more you do, right, the more you learn, the stronger it gets. And so you begin to solidify, to make permanent this information that you've learned. And that's how the brain works, right? That's how our brain does. So anytime we're given new information, right now we're talking about this, and maybe there's new information. Maybe you didn't know that. Maybe there were terms that of neurons and synapses and dendrites. Maybe you didn't know that. But there's new information, okay? And if you go home and Google it and look at all the cool pictures and stuff, like, oh, it may help kind of solidify that just a little bit. And that's how our brain learns. Well, the same thing is true when we talk about prayer. When we look at next week, when Jesus says to pray like this, and when we practice just like we did in the service, and we put it out in front of you, and we say, look, if prayer is important to Jesus, it should be important to us. And the only way for us to make sure you know how important it is for us is to show you that it's important to us, to make it a part of the culture of our church. And if we can expect you to make it important if we don't make it important. And so we talk about it, and that's why we're talking about it now, and that's why we're pushing an emphasis to say that we need to learn how to pray better, but that we can all learn how to pray better. And I know that too many people don't like to pray, that too many people think prayer is not a nuisance, but like it's just a thing that you do, maybe that you have to because that it's what Christians do, and so you'll pray before a meal, you'll pray before your kids go to bed. But it's deeper than that. And so wherever you are today, right, here's the good news. Wherever you are today, whatever level your prayer is, it's okay. Wherever you came in this morning, however much you like to pray, however much you don't like to pray, that's okay. But if we as a church are going to commit to worship God better, to worship God the way He desires and deserves to be worshiped, then we need to look at our prayer life and say, hey, can our prayer life be better? Yes. Can we learn to pray better? Yes. We can get over some of our anxiety and some of our fears. We can commit to learn and improve our prayer life. So I told you Tim Keller looked at prayer and said, man, there's so much more I need to know. And so he began to think about ways that he could pray more. And he told his wife, he said, let's pray daily. And so they started a practice. And they practiced for a few days, and then it just, you know, like a lot of things, it just things got in the way, and they didn't do it. And he tells the story, at the very beginning of the book, he tells a story that changed so much for him. And I think it's just a great little picture. His wife came to him and said, listen, you said you wanted to pray every day. Yes, I do. But we're not doing it. Like, we're letting life get in the way. He's like, yes, okay. Well, let me ask you a question. When the doctor told you, when you were diagnosed, right, with the cancer, with your disease, and the doctor said, you have to take this medicine every day, all right? You have to take it at this time. You have to take it with a meal. Whatever the instructions were, the doctor gave you the instructions. What did you do? It's like, I followed the instructions. Right. Did you miss a day? No. Why? Because the doctor said, if I didn't, I would die. Right. So you're going to take the medicine. You're going to do what your doctor says because the doctor is the expert, right? And you're going to do it every day because the doctor says do it every day. Right. And you're not going to miss a day. Why? Because it's too important. Right. Okay. So what's different with prayer? If we know that it's important and we see the Jesus models and we believe that it's something we're supposed to do, then why can't we find the time to do it? Why can't we learn how to do this better? And he said he was overwhelmed with conviction. And I read that story and I was overwhelmed with conviction because, man, you know what? I pray with my kids, but I say the same prayer every night. It's the same exact prayer I pray with them. In fact, I even try to pray differently, and we've done it for 14 years now because we started with someone who was first born. That they're like, okay, that was a great prayer. Now pray the thing that you pray every night. Because they're so used to it. It's like this little comfort blanket. And we try to change things. We try things. And, you know, life gets in the way. But it's like, if it's really important, you know, do we make it important? Yes. Can we learn to pray better? Yes. Can our kids learn to pray better? Yes. Can we model that for them? Yes. Can we, as a church, as individuals, commit to learn to pray? Yes. And we should. Yes. But if we're going to learn to pray better, then we have to practice prayer. Because here, as the disciple says, teach us, he's not only saying that prayer can be learned, But he's also showing a desire to be taught. And prayer is something that we should long to be taught. We should long to learn, which means that we should put it into practice. Now, the same neurons, the same dendrites, and the synapses, and as they build up and they come into something stronger, the more you practice it, okay, the more you practice it, the more it builds up this fatty layer, this fatty tissue called myelin. It's a myelin sheath, all right? Now, here's what's interesting. The dendrites are all new information, and when the synapse is connected, it connects this new information. And so as you practice the new information, I learned a G chord. The more I practice a G chord, that myelin sheath goes over, and so now that G chord solidified in my mind. If I pick up a guitar and I know where my fingers go, I don't have to think about it anymore. We all know that's true, just like we rode a bike. It's locked, right? It's locked in, all right? Well, can you pop a wheelie on a bike? That's new information, right? You may see that, and maybe it connects. Well, you go practice it, and as all of a sudden, you may grow, and you practice that some more, and it builds that myelin sheath, and you grow more. That's how you learn more chords. That's how you go deeper. That's how we get to the next level, and that applies to anything and everything in life, but it especially applies, we're talking about this, to prayer, which means that you've got to pray more than just before meals. We have to pray more than just transitional elements in the service. We have to pray more than just by ourselves. We have to pray more than just silence in our heads. We've got to practice new things. Now, what's interesting about how all that stuff connects in your brain, right, is that it builds on stuff you already know, okay? So you ever heard the phrase, you don't know what you don't know, right? So if there's no information, it's just neurons. So the new information gives you something new. So building and solidifying and practicing is something built on what you already know, that you've learned to pray. So if you don't know a whole lot, okay, well, you've heard about prayer, and you know something, so you can start from there, and you build on it. But the disciples' desire to learn how to pray shows that he wants to strengthen this bond. He wants to make it something that matters to him. He wants to make it important. He wants to put in the time. And he's asking the person who is modeling it for them, who's modeling it often, who is showing that it's personal, right? It's not just at a synagogue. It's not just a rote repetition. It means something. It's intentional. And when we desire to learn to pray better, when we desire, like this disciple did, to be taught how to pray better, to practice prayer in different ways and more opportunities and to get over those anxieties and those fears, we begin to see and experience something new, just like this disciple did. They knew what prayer was. They were building off what they already knew, but they saw something new and exciting and fresh. In J.I. Packer's book on prayer, he says that it's moving from, as we grow in our faith, we move from prayer as a duty to prayer as delight. That it's not something that we do just because we feel like we have to because of the food's in front of us. We do because we have to just because the pastor said, bow your heads, close your eyes. Those cannot be the only moments that you pray. If that's it, if the only moments you pray are the ones you feel like you have to because there's food or because that's what's happening in the service, then there's no desire to learn. And you're missing out on the opportunities to learn. So as J.I. Packer says, prayer moves from duty to delight. That's the question for you this morning. Like, is prayer a burden or is it a blessing? Do you see it as this thing you're just supposed to do because the pastor said or because that's what Christians do? Or do you see it as a blessing, something that grows you, it strengthens you, it helps you, it blesses you? What is prayer to you? Is it something that you want to learn? Is it something that you have a desire to be taught? I hope so. Because the other thing that we see in this verse is that prayer is something that in and of itself teaches. It is something that can be learned, and it is something that we should long to learn, but it is also something that in and of itself teaches. Look what it says. The disciple said, and this is one disciple too, by the way. Now, I don't know if this one disciple was the only person that desired to pray, or if he drew the short straw because none of the other disciples wanted to talk to Jesus about prayer. They felt embarrassed. I don't know what the reason is, but this one disciple shows us that he wants to learn and knows that he can learn, knows that his brain is going to help him process this. But look, He says, teach us to pray as John taught his disciples. Who's John? What's he talking about? He's talking about John the Baptist. And why John the Baptist? Because the way Jesus is praying is different than the way they understand prayer, the way they've seen prayer, the way they've practiced prayer. But it's familiar to something they know in John the Baptist. Now, John the Baptist told people to pray in an attitude of repentance. They told them to pray for the kingdom of God. He told them to pray often and loud. He was praying outside the synagogue in the wilderness. And he's baptizing people, and he was saying, look, we're baptizing you in a spirit of repentance and a desire for the kingdom of God to come. It's at hand. I mean, this is what he was telling people. And so his prayers were very purposeful. They were very intentional, and they were very loud, and they're very personal. They weren't just rote. They weren't just in the church service. They were in public and often. And so he looks at this and says, man, we've seen somebody else pray like this. This is a whole nother level of prayer. Teach me this. I want to pray like that. And what we begin to see is this picture of an attitude of the heart, right? That prayer is something special. It's something unique. It's something that connects us to God. Now, there are a whole bunch of books on prayer. I haven't even touched a fraction of them, just a handful of books I've read on prayer. But you can see, as you look through all the books that have been written on prayer, and there's a whole bunch of them, there's really kind of two camps of where what prayer is, right? There is the attitude that prayer, as we see it in Scripture, God says, come to him to ask, and we'll be given, like, to come to him with our needs, to know that he is providing, to know that he will guide us, to know that he will give, he will take care of us, not selfishly, but to honor him and to thank him and to be grateful, but to come with need. That's why we pray and ask for healing. That's why we pray and ask for guidance. That's why we prayed earlier and we said, look, there are people here that are struggling with jobs, and we come to God with that. Or the marriages that are going through challenges, and we come to God with that. Or the division of the nation, we come to God with that. And this idea of experiencing God and communion with God, and that's one way to perceive prayer. And there's another camp that looks at that and says, man, even when you're trying for that not to be selfish, it is completely selfish because you're asking for yourself. It's what you want. It's what you desire. You're praying for, your marriage. You're praying for your job, and you're not seeking God's will. And the real way to pray is to come before God and put his kingdom above all else, and not even to approach your needs, just to know that he's going to take care of it and to look specifically at the kingdom of God. And so you've got the camp that is communion, and you've got the camp that is just kingdom. But I look at the book of Psalms, which I think is God giving us kind of a handbook for prayer. And you know what I see in the book of Psalms? I see both. I don't see an either-or camp. I see that God says, I'm here for you. Come at me with anything. I mean, if you've never read the Psalms, I encourage you to read the Psalms. But here's what you see. There are several psalms where it is all about experiencing God in some new, exciting, fresh way. I mean, there's a whole bunch. Psalms 27, 63, Psalm 84, Psalm 131, there's a whole bunch of them. And the author is the way he writes it is like, wow, the way I see God is new and exciting and marvelous. But then you look at all the other psalms, and there are psalms of complaint. There are psalms that are cries for help. There are psalms that are asking God to demonstrate his power for whatever reason. There are psalms lamenting that God is not anywhere. There's frustration. There's joy. There's all these emotions. I mean, if you read it, it's all over the map. It's like a roller coaster. It's like high, low, back and forth, back and forth. And there isn't one camp for prayer. Just because the disciples had prayed by rote doesn't make that prayer wrong. If they're worshiping God in that, if they are coming to him with it, it doesn't matter if they're just reciting what's being said. And Jesus doesn't condemn their prayer. He doesn't say, don't ever pray like that. They ask him to teach the way he prays, and he says, okay, pray like this, and we're going to talk about that next week. He said, there is another way to pray. There's a deeper way to pray. But here's why this is such good news. Because it doesn't matter how great of a prayer you think you are, whether you don't think you have the words, whether you don't like to pray at all, if you want to experience God, and if you want to allow him to take over and truly lead you, all you really got to do is just pray. Because prayer teaches us to worship God. That's when we learn to pray, when we desire to be taught, we see that prayer teaches us that learning to pray is learning to worship. We begin to see God for who he is. When we track them like we asked you to do, and if you haven't done it, there are little notebooks in the seat in front of you, or we'll give you some at Oak Creek Center after the service to track your prayers, to begin to see that God is listening, and he's answering. And it might not be in the time that you want. It might not be in the way you want. But you read the Psalms, and God's like, hey, come at me with all of it. I've paved the way. I've made it wide open for you. In fact, when you read in Hebrews, it tells us that Jesus intercedes for us. This is so beautiful. Listen to me. Jesus intercedes for us, okay? In Romans, it tells us that God himself dwells in us. He's given us the Holy Spirit to pray for us, all right? What does that mean, right, to help us to pray? Because, in fact, that's what it says in Romans 8, that we really don't know how to pray, right? And we're going to mess it up when we pray. It doesn't matter how great we think we are. We're talking to God. I mean, can we ever say the words just right? Can we ever get it just right? But here's what we learn. And let me just say, I didn't make this up. Somebody after last service told me this. It's beautiful. It's like we bring God a lump of coal, man. That's our prayer. This is what I have. And Jesus, who intercedes for us, the Holy Spirit, who helps us to pray, they take it and they polish it and they squeeze it and they do it. It's like Superman, right? And it's a diamond. And they go, here, Father. This one's with me. Like, we come to God. He's given us access. He allows us to talk to him. Jesus intercedes and says, this is family. He's with me. And the Father says, bring whatever. So it doesn't matter how you pray. It doesn't matter how good you think you are, right? He's going to listen. He's going to take it. Because it's just a step in the right direction to seeing him as a provider, the guider, it's the one who loves, it's the one who cares. But knowing that he allows us to come to him, we should want to learn to pray. Knowing that there's so much more we can do with our prayer, we should desire to learn. And to know that prayer is that foundation of worship, we should let it teach us to worship God better. Because prayer it's not an either-or thing, right? Prayer is reflection, but it's also a desire for the kingdom of God. Prayer is contemplation, but it's also obedience to God's will. Prayer is communion, but it's also conformity to God's purpose. But the question we have to ask ourselves this morning, me included, I have so much more to learn about prayer. Do you want to learn? Do you want to be like this disciple who comes to Jesus and says, teach me. Help me see how important it is. Show me how to pray. That we have a desire to learn. I mean, that really is the question. Do you want to learn? Do you want the desire to pray better? Do you want to pray and practice it and lock it in with that myelin sheath and to know that it's permanently and you continue to build on it and it gets better and better. And just like anything else, the more you practice it, the easier it. Listen, there's some of you here who you've never prayed out loud in public. But you know what happens after the first time you do? It gets easier the second time. There are some of you who are like, I just don't have the words. I don't know the right words. But you know what happens? When you pray with the words you've got, the next time you pray with more words. Like, I just feel uncomfortable praying with other people. Listen, the first time you pray with someone else, you know what happens the next time? You want to pray with more people. Because it's just like anything else that we learn. It's just like anything else that we practice. If we desire it, if we want to be a great guitar player, if we want to be great at anything, we put the time and effort and energy. So that's the question is, do you want it? We're making it important as a church. And our prayer is that you make it important as an individual. Because learning to pray is learning to worship. And if we want to worship God the way he desires, the way he deserves to be worshiped, then we must learn how to pray. We must desire to learn how to pray. And we must let prayer teach us to worship him that way. In fact, let's do this right now. Let's pray. Let's just take a moment to pray. And everyone does the knee-jerk thing that we've been taught to do, right? We bow our heads. Why do we do that? We bow our heads because we're coming before the God. I mean, what happens when you approach a king? What happens when you come into his throne room? What happens when you approach someone who you have honor for and reverence for? You approach him humbly. That's what it represents. But you don't have to do that. You want to stand up and lift your hands up? That's okay. You want to kneel down? That's okay. Because God says, bring it all to me. There's no style. There's no format. We bow our heads and we close our eyes. Why do we close our eyes? Because we're supposed to be focusing. We're not supposed to be thinking about lunch. We're not supposed to be thinking about noises. We're supposed to be thinking about him. What does that stir in us? What happens? What? So there are people in here who get it, and there are people in here who don't. But Father, the prayer this morning is that everyone in here will desire to learn to pray, desire to take their prayer life to the next level. And maybe that means that they actually do focus when they close their eyes, that they actually do have reverence when they bow their head. Or they don't follow a pattern. They stand up or they kneel or they do something else because they're doing what they need to do to honor you with their prayer. Father, these moments are, they're awkward and they're weird because there's silence. There's a guy on stage praying for people in here. And I don't know what anyone's thinking and what anyone's doing, but you do. So I can only ask that every heart in here would be tuned in. That would be processing their prayer life and what steps they could take, what else they can do. That men in this room, especially men, who are called to be the spiritual leaders, would not throw away prayer like it's a frivolous thing, but would lead. That they would take the steps necessary to be the prayer warriors. It's far too often the women, and not that that's a bad thing, but us men, we're falling behind. And we're supposed to be championing this. They're supposed to be following our lead, and we've given up. That it cannot be true for this church. It shouldn't be true for any church. But God, may you especially imprint on the hearts of the men in this church to desire to learn to pray. Give us the confidence to overcome our fears, the courage to get past anxiety and come to you, because that's all that matters. It is not for anybody else. It's for you. It's for me. It's for the one that comes to you in prayer, that we would know who you are, and our learning to pray would be learning to worship you the right way. We give you this, and we pray it in your name, because you told us to. You said when we pray it in Jesus' name that you hear it, you receive it. So we pray it in Jesus' name. And if everyone in here agrees, then we all say, amen.